Hachette Audio presents The Dime, written by Kathleen Kent, read by Cynthia Farrell. For Jim. A patient woman can roast an ox with a lantern. Chinese proverb. 1. Norman Avenue and Jewel Street, Greenpoint, Brooklyn. Monday, October 23rd, 2000. From my position in the hallway, on my ass, head pressed against the doorframe, legs drawn up with my gun held two-handed against my sternum, I try to recall the layout of the room. Three sets of bunk beds, four corpses sprawled across bloodied sheets, my partner, shot three times, lying motionless next to the nearest bunk, and somewhere in there, one lunatic. A screaming infant in one hand and a semi-automatic pistol in the other. The last time I sneaked a look around the open doorway, he fired at me, the bullet knocking a crater in the wall opposite. He followed up by threatening to shoot the baby and then himself. I've been a cop for 5 months, 1 week, and 9.5 hours. It was the crying baby that brought us to the apartment in the first place. Dispatch had gotten a call from the super of a three-story residential building on Norman Avenue of four shots fired inside one of the top-floor apartments. My partner, an older, more experienced Brooklyn cop named Ted O'Hanlon, and I were only minutes away. The stairway was narrow up to the second floor, and several neighbors, mostly thick-waisted women and some small kids, were milling around, more curious than frightened. Ted had told everyone to clear the hallway, to stay inside their apartments, and we climbed cautiously to the third floor, hands on our service pistols. We could hear the baby crying as soon as we reached the landing. It was a healthy, steady cry that made me think no one was holding it. The super had let us know that the place opposite the possible shooter's apartment was empty, so no chance of a neighbor stumbling out at the wrong time. Approaching the apartment, we saw that the door was open a small crack, and as we drew our weapons, Ted called out, "NYPD, hello? Everybody okay?" Ted had approached the door slowly, on point, and he palmed it open with his left hand. "Jesus," he'd said. I was right behind him, and being taller than him by several inches, at 5'11", I'm taller than a lot of the men in my squad, I got a good look inside. A pristine, almost sterile living room with the three bunk beds set against three separate walls, written in orange spray paint above each top bunk, and again in giant letters on the graying linoleum covering the floor, was the word uplifted. Crude, childlike drawings of winged stick figures were painted onto the struts of the beds. Pale sunlight, spilling in from the rear kitchen window, made everything in the room appear hazy and indistinct. There was no movement, no sound except for the baby wailing. There were four people in the first two sets of bunks, two females and two male youths, all dressed alike in dark blue sweatsuits, their arms neatly crossed over their chests, all shot in the head. There was a larger figure completely covered with a gory blanket on the lower bed of the third bunk. Next to the bulky shape was the baby, red-faced and squalling. My partner motioned to me to stay in the doorway and instructed me to call dispatch for backup and medical. Then Ted, a man who had once jumped into the icy waters of Newton Creek in a January snowstorm to save a stray dog, turned his attention to the baby. And then I remembered the super had said he'd heard four shots, not five. My mouth opened to warn him when the bulky figure under the blanket reared up and fired three rounds at Ted, hitting him squarely in his torso. Instinctively, I threw myself to the floor and scrabbled into the safety of the hallway as he fired in my direction. I waited for him to rush me, but instead he started pacing frantically, ranting in the kind of fiery, talking in tongues nonsense of manic televangelists. Barauna beresh peka, beresh onta bauna, interspersed with tuneless, agitated humming. A few months of street patrol, giving out parking tickets and chasing kids pilfering oranges from a neighborhood fruit stand, did not prepare me for this. Backup was on its way, but much too slowly. Benny, I think now, what do I do? My uncle, a decorated homicide cop, mentor, and father figure who'd seen just about everything there was to see on the streets of Brooklyn, had never, to my knowledge, said anything about a gun-wielding, baby-slinging, murdering cult guy. But just like that, I hear Benny's voice in my head telling me, "Betty, chaos and crazy people has its own pattern. You gotta break the pattern, jam up the works." Some of his wisdom remembered through the thick fog of fear. The guy is chanting again, "Ready for uplift, ready for uplift," his voice rising to a hysterical pitch. "The angel says be ready for uplift." I try to think about all the clues in the room. The drawings, the word uplifted scrawled on the walls, what the victims are wearing. They're in sweatsuits, but the shooter's got on a Mets jersey. At the top of my lungs, I scream out, "Fuck the Yankees!" There is a pause in the squeaking of his shoes. "That's right," I yell. "You heard me! Fuck the Yankees!" Even over the baby's shrill crying, I can sense him listening, straining to hear what I'll say next. "That guy Clemens," I say. "Can you believe what he did? Slinging the bat like that at Mike? Did you see that game 3 months ago when he beamed Mike in the head?" I'm soaking every word with as much disdain and outrage as I can summon, hoping to God, or whatever power is watching over the Subway series the entire country is watching, that it's enough to distract this lunatic. I hear sirens approaching Norman Avenue. There'll be more officers here within 4 minutes. But that may be 3 minutes too late. "He shouldn't have done that," the guy says sadly, like he's just lost his childhood pet. "Right?" I say. "Hey, did you watch the whole game yesterday?" It sounds like he's repositioning the baby, shushing it gently, as though he hasn't just been threatening to shoot it in the head. "Yeah," he says. "They ought to do something about that guy Clemens." "What did you say?" I call out. "I can't hear you so well over the baby crying." I ease myself to a standing position, sliding up the doorframe, taking deep breaths to quiet my shaking hands. The sirens are louder now, and I'm afraid the piercing sounds will only hasten the impending violence. He yells, "They ought to do something about Clemens. He's dangerous." "He's a thug," I yell back, and then, softly, "Too bad the Mets lost that one. The Mets can be such losers." "What?" the guy calls out. "What did you say?" "Hey," I say, my cheek pressed hard against the doorframe. "I really want to talk to you about the game, but honestly, I can't hear what you're saying over the baby crying. You think you could set the baby down just for a sec so we can have a conversation?" The guy's humming dangerously again, and it sounds like the responding officers, and probably the medical units, have arrived at the front of the building. "Come on," I plead, "just for a minute. Christ, all this crying's giving me a headache. Did you ever meet any of the Mets in person?" There's a long pause, and then he says, "I shook Piazza's hand once." "No shit," I say, closing my eyes. "You shook Mike's hand?" I can hear voices coming up the stairwell. My palms are sweating so bad that I'm afraid I'll drop the gun. "Okay," the guy says. The tone of his voice is flat, all enthusiasm for baseball gone. "I'm going to set the baby down. She's tired. I need to put her to sleep first." I risk a glance into the room. He's bending over the squirming infant, who he's placed on the bare floor. The gun is pointed at the baby. He's saying, "And then we can talk about the me—" I fire 6 times, a tight cluster of body shots. He crashes heavily against one of the bunk beds and falls into a sitting position, legs spread wide. He jerks a few times and then slumps forward. I melt onto the floor.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.